this most amazing man. We haven't even talked about the fact that in his last year he was doing watercolors, beautiful watercolors. Every day he would do a new one. And the last time I saw him, he was talking to me about the Brothers Karamazov, which he was having another go-through, seeing all sorts of new things in it. And he was abrupt. I remember him walking out of a conference once in Burlington and not showing up again for a couple of days. I don't know how he got home, but we never worried about him. He always took care of himself. But the one image that I would like us to remember him by occurred, I guess it was two winters ago at the winter meeting. And it's an image that has been preserved, and it has Bob reaching out to Ira. The same orange hat, and many ties I had with Bob, the one that meant the most, I think, to both of us was our love of William Blake. And I just would say that this summed up Bob in a line from Blake's Auguries of Innocence, which said that he who keeps the infant's faith shall triumph over hell and death.
Bob was one of my oldest friends. My and our, that's Helen and I, we were in tandem at the starting at the General Strike for Peace and the crazy living theater in those crazy days of the early 1960s. Bob was one of our oldest friends, and there is no one in the world like Bob, no one, with his red cheeks and red running nose and wild white eyebrows and his sweater always worn backwards and inside out, invariably both contrary ways together, backside front and inside out. My feelings about Bob, who I loved and who also provoked me because I couldn't always get his jagged, contradictory meanings. Bob, the binary man, who so often needed to say yes and no at the same time, with his poet's character running straight through the confusion. Bob, who would slow to 10 miles an hour on a busy highway when became ardent about what he was talking about. And I remember a specific place on the road between Montpelier, and Bob was such a baddie driver, such a wonderful baddie guy. And we were talking and he was so earnest. He was driving and he kept slowing down, and there was traffic. This was night, there was traffic all around, and because he had to emphasize the point, he practically came to a dead stop in the middle of all of this traffic. And you know, maybe that's how Bob was in general, coming practically, bringing things to a dead stop because of the marvelous things, marvelous and crazy things that were going through his mind. Peter spoke about his red cheeks. He seemed to have so much health, and with that, the running nose all the time. And he was like a special vegetable, a special flower with his flaming red cheeks. I don't know what health or unhealth that denoted, but his red cheeks and his red nose, he was like a flaming brand of youth with that face of his and the white eyebrows. Oh, I want to say one more thing. It's endless. I mean, this goes back 50 years, and we first met Bob on the flatbed truck that Duncan's little obituary spoke about, and that was a brilliant thing that Bob did. He hired a flatbed truck, and he got a bunch of theater people, including us. Papa, and that's where I think... That's where I first worked with Peter. I had seen mm-hmm. Peter before.
Just we did Mansell's Goodbye on the flatbed truck.
Right. I don't remember what you did, but you had an independent section.
But the flatbed truck was a big thing in the, what was that, 65, 64? Something like that.
64, 63 maybe even.
Yeah, 60-something. So flatbed, a brilliant idea, you know, to take theater to the streets, or to take a flatbed truck, invite poets to read against the wall in the back of it, and inviting us, and we did theater pieces right into the street, just stop it by the side of the road, and do street theater. You're elevated by the height of the truck above the people. You know, it's fantastic. Typical Bob idea.
Yeah.
And he did not only, I mean, he had a reputation as this, you know, redesigner, famous redesigner of Washington Square and all that. But then later on, he did radical redesigns. He did Tompkins Square redesign. And he did that with the help of his own self-created Puerto Rican kid companies that he created. He went to clubs in the area, he learned to know the kids, and he engaged them. And then he went to the piers, to the broken down piers on the west side, and he picked up all these old beams there, and every night he would truck them to Tompkins Square Park, and the kids would build what they called clubhouses from that stuff. And Bob trucked in giant spikes and hammers that were sewn all the time, so he had to do it every day. And they built there what they called clubhouses, wild pieces of architecture, right in the middle of Tompkins Square Park, only to burn each other out, also every night. There were violent fires there, almost every night. So they all burned each other out because they were, you know, clubs that were not friendly towards each other. So, but Bob kept going with this. And then finally, the city made him redesign the park. You know, he then worked on the park in a more legal way to make it, make new areas, grassy knolls to, unfortunately, also a lot of fences. I think before it didn't have fences, but I think that was by the cities ordering him to do so, I imagine.
Ah, but there was something radical in that park. Mm-hmm. When he redesigned it, there were, you know, mounds of earth because they're digging, and the kids are running up and down the mounds of earth. Bob decides, I'm not going to flatten them out. He just made it into part of the park with, you know, whatever that's still called. Not mounds of
asphalt.
Earth, but...
And then it became like this roller skating acrobatics place. Yeah.
The first time I saw Bob, it was at a place in Greenwich Village called Abingdon Square, which is big. And I was standing with a friend on the west side of the square facing the east side, and this very strange person is walking across the square, not exactly on the sidewalk, just, and I swear, the way he was walking and looking up, you know, he was in the forest, you know. I guess those were houses, but it was as if they were the trees. And he just kept going and then eventually disappeared into a narrow street, maybe Bank Street or something, but it was as if he disappeared into the forest.
Mm-hmm. There's this wonderful apartment Bob had on 11th Street between Avenue A and B. And I guess at some point he finally moved out and it became...
Hangout.
I don't know how it was decided it would be bequeathed to me. It was a beautiful place. It's fifth floor, and the classic, you come in, there was a bathtub in the kitchen, a little bathroom, and this beautiful big room opening up into the courtyard with this huge tree. It's a great place. And I met Bob, and he decided I was worthy, but I got to be friends with him since then, and that's one of the lucky things in my life. I'm really happy about that, Bob and Grace.
I have a program that goes into prisons, and Bob and Grace both said, if you need a place to stay, you come here and you stay at my house. So I did that from a few of the programs, and every single day, every single morning and evening, if I did not go and tell them both what I had, what had happened during the day, they were seriously mad at me. And Bob would say, "What are you doing? How come you're not here? You know, we need to know." You know, And then one day there was a show, and they went to see the show, and there was a big blizzard, and none of the people from the outside came, which was very important for the inmates, right? And we were all there preparing. The only people that made it was Bob and Grace. Mm-hmm. And not only that, but what was interesting was that they did not have IDs, which is pretty bad. And going to a prison. So Bob is like with the hands in his pocket. And the guard was tiny, tiny, this very big, stocky woman. So, you know, and then I couldn't go there. It was at the entrance. And I'm checking, and then it's 15 minutes later, and he's like this, looking at her. And then the woman explaining, half an hour later, the same thing. And he's like, And the inmates were furious, 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 because how come you don't let this to, you know, just this old couple and coming here to support us? So we had a very late show. But they were right there. They were sitting there. We called the superintendent, and they were sitting right there. And it was, I have to say, that it was so, so meaningful to the women that for many, many years later, they would ask me for them. And it was just so important. And the blizzard, and they kept remembering their presence. And Bob was never... He was just always listening to all the women. Every single show he went to see, he would listen to them. Tell me what you have to say after the show. That was, and I'm very thankful for them to be with me.
I just wanted to speak to the sacred and the profane in Bob's life. He had a deep, deep mystical spirituality that every day he would go into the woods and kneel down in front of a certain tree, and he was very, very quiet about it, but he had a lot of connection to sort of the Christian mystical tradition. I think maybe he was quiet about it, partly out of respect for Grace and her people. Douglas, who's here, gave him a great gift towards the end of his life of teaching him meditation, which he used a lot and had little notes up to remind himself about experiences with that. And it was very clear that that was part of what helped him with his passing. To really do it well. So that's one side of Bob. And the other side is one of the things that stands out for me with Bob, and I'm sure there are many stories here, is how many opportunities he found to expose his body in public. I was sometimes his healthcare provider, and he always managed to come up with a rash where he had to drop his drawers to show me what was going on. Or if he had a tick, it had to be on his genitals. Or but my favorite, and it's very, I just was sort of shook my head and laughed when I realized that in his end of life care, we were all going to be having to deal with. His private parts on a daily basis. But the best story was when he told me himself, where he was walking in the woods, and near a little, he didn't know, I guess, although maybe he did with those other stories, near a little beach on the Ompompanoosuc River that set up like a little amphitheater. And he decided that he was gotten too hot and needed to go for a swim, and went behind a tree, took off all his clothes, and came out of the trees to the river, and the entire Girl Scout camp was sitting on the amphitheater. I saw Bob with his crazy hair, and they all screamed. dream. You can imagine what memories were created for them. For several years in the, I think it was the late 80s, Joel and I used to camp out with Bob and Grace at the Conleys campsite. Mm-hmm. And Bob and Grace both really enjoyed camping, and we always had cocoa in the morning and tea, both. And we always had Red River cereal, which would always burn. But Bob insisted on washing the pot, which was quite a chore because I don't know if anybody remembers what a mess Conley's was and how little water there was available. One night, going to bed, and Bob came up and said, "You've got to come. It's amazing." And I went down. Nobody else. Grace was talking to somebody and didn't want to come. And Bob and I went down to it was one of these Jesus buses that had come with a whole group of people. And he said, "They're amazing." And we went, and they offered us to come into the bus and have tea. And we drank tea, and there was music, and the girls were dancing with these beautiful skirts. And Bob really didn't want to be inside the bus. He'd much rather be out dancing and seeing the girls. But afterwards, he didn't say anything. We just walked out, and he said, "What kind of tea was that?" And I don't know.